not only on this last day of Advent, but the last hour of Advent, to remind ourselves that Christ has come and Christ is coming again. During the season of Advent, you know that we've lit a candle every week to remind ourselves of the principles that are embodied in Christ that now dwell within us. The first candle that we light is for hope. The second is for love. The third is for joy. And the final one is for peace. And as the ushers come and light those four candles at the end of this service, we will light the fifth candle, which symbolizes the true light of the world that has come in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. While those candles are being lit, hear the word of the Lord. And it came to pass in those days that a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. The census first took place while Quirinius was governing Syria. So all went to be registered, everyone to their own city. Joseph also went up from Galilee out of the city of Nazareth into Judea to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and the lineage of David. He went there to be registered with Mary, his betrothed wife, who was with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were completed for her to be delivered. She brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling cloths and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. Now there were in the same country shepherds living out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. And the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. For behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling cloths lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men and women." And so it was when the angels had gone away from them into heaven that the shepherds said to one another, "Let us now go to Bethlehem and see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us." And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. Now when they had seen him, they made widely known the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all those who heard it marveled at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. Then the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen as it was told them. Won't you bow and be in prayer? Lord, as the shepherds heard the words of the angels, they made haste to Bethlehem to see the marvel of Jesus in a manger. And tonight, oh God, we've gathered in this place the two. Like them, we may be filled with the joy and the peace of finding Christ in our lives. That as the shepherds went away glorifying and praising you, we might leave this place glorifying and praising you for Christ who has come. That we might share this message with the world, that the world may marvel in the love of Christ. Lord, be with us now. Grant us the privilege of your presence as we seek to worship you. In the name of our Savior and our Christ, we do pray, amen. As we gathered in the day this evening, we began with caroling on a portico, and I know that our hearts were filled with joy. There's nothing like singing a good Christmas carol. So I'm gonna ask that you would stand and join with us as we lift our voices together in song, hymn number 132, "Angels We Have Heard on High," as we lift together this congregational hymn. Would you bow and be in prayer with me as we thank God for the opportunity to give? Lord, as a child, I didn't understand why you loved a cheerful giver. But the older I've gotten in life and realized how good you've been to me, an opportunity to give to you ought to make me smile. We don't do so begrudgingly or with a bad attitude, but with thanksgiving. And Lord, my prayer is that what we give today would be used to touch someone else with the love of Jesus Christ in this Christmas season, that you'd give wisdom and discernment to this leadership of this church family, that we may be good stewards of these offerings that are sown tonight, that with them, Lord, someone else may feel the love of Jesus Christ. Thank you for the opportunity to give, and we give with a joyful heart. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Good evening, Alfred Street. This Christmas, I'd like to talk about the nativity story from Joseph's opinion. As he approaches Mary, I've waited patiently for you to be my wife, 'cause you're the only one I want to share my life. So how can this thing be when we have not been wed? How can you bear a child when we have shared no bed? I try and try to understand, but I'm only a man, just living life the best I can. Well, maybe our God has shown us favor, a savior forever. I hear this child will rule all nations, generations will bless his name, bless his name. How can a virgin girl conceive a holy child? Must I accept this birth and have my name defiled? How can a carpenter raise a son divine when all I wanted was a child that's yours and mine? You say that it fulfills God's word, that his message must be heard, that all men will hail this blessed birth. Maybe our God has shown us favor, a savior forever. I hear this child will rule all nations, generations will bless his name. His name, bless his name, bless his name, bless his name. His name, bless his name, bless his name, bless his name, bless his
It came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus
that all the world should be taxed. And this taxation was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria, and all went to their cities, everyone to their hometown to be taxed. And Joseph went out of the area of Galilee, the city of Nazareth, into Judea, the city of Bethlehem, which is called the city of David, because he was of the line and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was, while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son. She wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for him in the inn. Let us pray. God, who made himself known to us in this child, make yourself known to us in the proclamation of your word. Amen. Amen. When I was pregnant for the first time a long time ago, I had this habit. Just about every day, for a half hour, you could find me in front of a television program that came out on TLC's network called A Baby Story. Now, I watched this because, like Mary, I had never had a child before. And because my mother wasn't alive, I didn't have anyone to ask all those questions to. And it helped me. I was trying to figure this pregnancy thing out, and the great unknown to me was, would I actually be able to do it? You watch the show, and there are those calm earth mothers who just seem to be so in tune with the universe. And I wondered, would I be one of those? And then there was the woman who would curse at her husband every time he tried to bring her an ice chip, you know, the ice chip. And I thought, maybe, is that gonna be me? And then there's the woman who just got up off the bed halfway through and said, I quit. And they said, no, you have to stay. And I wondered, would I need drugs? Would I have a C-section? How's this thing going to be? I was pregnant, but I didn't know how I was going to get to parent. This in-between step was covered in darkness. And I watched the show, and I lived vicariously through all these families, and I learned something. I learned that there are straightforward, or what they call by-the-book deliveries, and there are complicated and dangerous and life-threatening deliveries. But nothing about birth is ever simple. So I want you to look with me at the passage that Pastor read at the beginning of service that I just shared a small portion of with you. And I would venture to say it's a passage we are all very familiar with. Many of you, like me, learned it for a Sunday school play a long, long time ago. And if you've never been to church, you probably heard Linus say it in the Peanuts Christmas special. We know how the story goes. Mary and Joseph in Bethlehem, no room in the inn, go out to some kind of stable or cave, a place where animals are kept. She delivers the baby and puts him in the manger. And then over here in the same country are shepherds, and the shepherds hear the angels, and the shepherds come to Jesus. We know all of the pieces of the passage, but the beauty of Scripture is that there's always more. And there's something that we all know about the Gospel of Luke. Some of us know it because we went to seminary, and some of us know it because we go to Alfred Street, and we learn things at Alfred Street. One of the things we learned was that the Gospels were written decades after Jesus walked this earth, that the stories were written to preserve the tradition when it became a possibility that Jesus would not die before that first, Jesus would not come back before that first generation of disciples died. So we know what Luke was trying to say, but I want you to think about how he said it, because the way Luke tells the story tells us something about his theology. Luke uses space. He's very interested in location, and he's got to get Mary and Joseph to Bethlehem to have that baby. So he starts with these two major regions, right? We've got Galilee and Judea. Then we've got Nazareth and Bethlehem. And Mary and Joseph go from Galilee to Judea to Bethlehem to the place where the child is born. They're in an inn. They find themselves outside of the inn, and the baby is born in that space. And in a very similar space, we have shepherds who come to this location. And from that place, they go out to spread the good news. You could make the case that the manger is the epicenter of this story. And what's interesting about the way Luke tells this story is that even the delivery of the child is in a location. He says, and it so happened while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And then her entire birth takes place in a half verse, and she brought forth her firstborn son. There it is. Now that's Luke's version. Let me tell you how TLC, A Baby Stories version, goes. And so it happened that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And then Mary's water broke. And Mary said, Joseph, my water broke. And Joseph said, well, now we can't stay in the inn because it's really crowded and we were going to have to share a room, but we can't share a room while we're having a baby. So they find a place outside where she can labor. And in that first stage of labor, she's getting her sea legs as her body makes room for the baby. Then it's in that space that Mary moves into the second stage of labor, and about now we're hoping the midwife is there. Remember, everywhere in the ancient world, there were midwives, because giving birth was women's business. So even Luke, who is a doctor, wouldn't be aware of all of the things that happen when a woman gives birth. And Joseph is a righteous man, but he's never done this. So we're hoping there's a midwife who's helping Mary during that second stage of labor. Then she goes to the third stage of labor. This is what we call transition. This is when the pains are so great that you can't tell when one ends and the other one begins. And you're doing everything that they tell you to do, and you get to a point where you think, I cannot do it any longer. And that's when the midwife says, Mary, just one more push. Just one more push. And she brought forth her firstborn son and laid him in a manger and wrapped him in swaddling clothes. Luke's version doesn't have the detail that we might like. And it's not because Luke is at a loss for words. Chapter 1, the story about the conception of Jesus and John the Baptist, is 80 verses. That's a long chapter. Chapter 2, the story of the birth of Christ, is 52 verses. So it's not that Luke doesn't know how to communicate. It's not that he's stingy with words. But we just get a half verse about the delivery of the Christ child. And I want us to consider the possibility that that lack of detail is actually a gift. We're not going to get distracted by the details of what happened with Mary because they're not there for us to draw our attention away. Maybe the reason that we don't get that much about Mary's birth is because Luke is trying to do something with us about location. The birth takes place, we move from Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, to an inn, outside of an inn, to a cave or a stable. But the most important location, the most important space, is Mary herself. Mary is the location, the space that holds the baby Jesus. Mary is the person to whom we want to direct our imagination as we think of her not just as a person, but as a symbol for what it means to receive the incarnation of Jesus Christ. If we look at Mary as a symbol, and we recognize that Mary is the place where Jesus begins his embodiment, then we have to recognize that there are elements of the incarnation that are hidden from us. Think about it. Mary, you know, mind your own business. The angel Gabriel comes. You heard Pastor Wesley talked about it just a day ago. And the angel tells Mary she's going to have a baby, and Mary says, how's it going to happen? The Holy Spirit. Okay? Does anybody know what that means? We don't know how the Holy Spirit did this. We don't know anything other than that. So think about it. The conception of Jesus and the birth of Jesus are both mysteries to us. And this is important because some of the most important moments in our life will happen under the cover of darkness. Some of the most pivotal events in our life will happen where no one else can see. It'll be off the grid and underneath the radar and just take up one half of a verse. But because Mary carried the Christ child, she learned that God's presence can be greatest in places where no one else is with you. God's presence is great in our wilderness. God's presence is great in the darkness. God's presence is great when we labor. And when you understand the way God's presence works, then you realize you don't have to understand it in order for God to do it. We don't have to understand it. We don't have to quantify God's mercy in order to receive it. You don't have to have an algorithm for God's grace. And you do not have to weigh how much Holy Spirit you have on a given day. In fact, I want to suggest there should be a part of your story, no matter how many times you tell it, that should include the words, I still can't explain how God did it. Some of the best stories I know about God include lines like, I don't know why, I can't figure out how, and I don't know when, but this I know. This I know, God saw fit to do a work in me. You don't have to understand it. You know, I tell people all the time, because I don't know why, but people often come up to me and say, Dr. Judy, you're a theologian. And I say, no, I'm not. I'm not a theologian. And let me tell you why. Theologians are people who sit around and spend all day thinking about things like the incarnation. What does it mean for God to be fully human and fully God? They spend all day thinking about it, writing about it, reading about it. I don't have time for any of that. I'm not interested in how it happened, but I'm so glad that it did. God's incarnation is a mystery. Another thing we can learn from Mary has to do with the meaning of Emmanuel. We understand this word to mean God with us. And that is, in fact, what Emmanuel means. But it is also God in us. Now, stay with me, because one of the reasons the disciples had such a hard time with Jesus is because they were waiting for the Messiah. And the Messiah had been long promised, and the Messiah is going to come, and the Messiah was going to be with them. And they needed someone with them against Roman oppression. They wanted God with us, alongside us, beside us, for us, on our side, protecting us, fighting our battles, and tearing down the Roman Empire. They wanted all of that. But all of the space that they wanted their God to occupy was external. Right? And here comes Jesus
talking about the kingdom of God is within.
We don't need that. This idea of God in us is problematic because now we have to make changes. And as anyone knows who's carried a child, if there is something inside of you, things have to move around. You have to make room for something else. God takes space up in us. God wants to take residence in us and pushes things out of the way. God's presence in us demands our first fruits. You know, the baby eats first. God's presence in us dislodges and dislocates things. And if we nourish God's presence in us, it will keep growing. So we understand, like Mary, that God in us transforms us. And we understand, like the disciples, that the fact that you have suffered and the fact that you've been marginalized does not exempt you from the work God has to do in you. Think about this. The disciples were oppressed by Rome. And sometimes when you've been oppressed for a long time, you get really good at rehearsing how bad it is. You get really good about talking about your enemy. In fact, you spend a lot of time focused on the powers that are over you, so much so that you forget about the power within you. Okay? So Jesus comes to these people who want to be freed from Rome, and Jesus says, but you are in bondage to sin. And God wants us to be free from external oppression and internal oppression. Hear this, because you don't have to make a choice. Sometimes people will make you think that if your God wants to save your soul, your God cares nothing about what happens in the world. And some people think God only cares about what happens in the world and the soul will take care of itself. But Jesus wants to operate in all the spaces. Now, this is important because if we don't change and God tears down an oppressive power, we will quickly reconstruct one, right? We will do it again. So the work has to happen in both levels. God with us, God in us. What we learn if we look at Mary as a symbol is that the incarnation will mean that there will be some labor pains. Some people think that because Mary gave birth to Jesus, that it was smooth sailing. I don't believe that. I believe that if Jesus was acquainted with all of our experiences, maybe Mary got some of that too. And the only way for Mary to deliver Jesus was to experience discomfort, which is a nice way of saying it hurt like the dickens. The only way to bring God's plan of salvation into the world is to labor on. Now, I'm not a big fan of pain. I don't believe in unnecessary suffering. But the reality is, sometimes the fact that this world is not our home will overtake us. The pervasiveness of injustice, the sin of all the isms, all of them, children born into poverty, generations that have never known justice will remind us that the Roman Empire is alive and well. And you may have never carried a child, but that doesn't mean you're not weighed down. And you may have never experienced morning sickness, but that does not mean you are not discomfited by the circumstances of this life. The incarnation matters because it makes us co-laborers for the kingdom of God. Co-laborers for God's kingdom. So when we were in Israel back in October, one of the things that surprised me was my exposure to the veneration of Mary in early Christianity. Yeah. I grew up, you know, evangelical, so we didn't do that Mary thing. And so I was surprised to see how that developed. And one of the things that really just touched me was this image of Mary as the Ark of the Covenant. Right? Isn't that cool? Think about it. So the Ark in the Old Testament is this container that holds God's law. Mary is the container that holds God's word. And if Mary is the Ark of the Covenant, then we, as a result of the incarnation, carry within us this precious word of God. We carry this word of God, and we labor. The writer of Paul says that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory to be revealed in us. He goes on to say, we know that the whole creation has been groaning in labor pains until now. We labor to see God's kingdom. We labor to see freedom and liberation in our lives. We labor for restoration of our families. We labor for justice in the prison system. We labor for an end to a government shutdown. We labor for an end to foolishness in government. We labor and groan with creation. And on this Christmas Eve, whether you are in that first stage of labor, or the second one, or that third stage where you are saying, I cannot go another step, the Holy Spirit, who is our midwife, will come along and whisper in your ear, just one more push. We labor together to bring God's kingdom into the world because of the incarnation of Christ. And so we sing joy to the world. The Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room. Make room, church. Make room.
God who is not only with us, but God who desires to be in us. May we make room in our hearts for your word, for our Savior, and for your Holy Spirit. Come now, O King, reign and rule over these thy people. And in those moments when the labor is difficult, may the Holy Spirit give us the comforting advice, one more push. In Jesus' name we pray. As we prepare to depart from this place, I'm going to ask the usher to come and light our final candle. Our choir will recess with the song of Silent Night, while we meditate and allow the word of God to enter in us, not simply be around us. And then we'll leave in the grace and the peace of God.
Thank you.
In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God, and all things were made through him. And without him, nothing was made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of humanity. And the light shines in darkness, and the darkness cannot comprehend it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. This man came for a witness, to bear witness of that light, that all through him might believe. He was not the light, but he was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light which gives light to everyone coming into the world. This light was in the world, and the world was made through him, but the world did not know him. He came to his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become sons and daughters of God, to those who would believe in his name, who were born not only of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of humanity, but of the will of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. The glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. As you leave this place, may you bear witness to the light that has come in Jesus Christ. Merry Christmas. Amen. Amen.